And I want to start with something very classical, namely a theorem by Albert Brauer, Hasse, and Noether, which says the following, that if you look at the Brauer group of a global field, so the classes of central simple algebras, then, and you look at the map from there to the product of the Brauer groups over all the completions, where this goes over all the places, then this is injective. Another way to say this is that if you have a central simple algebra over F, then it's split if and only if it splits over all the completions. So now you can ask yourself, can you do something like this for other fields F? And what can you say? And so it's known that if you look at something higher dimensional, so if you look at a function field over a global field, then in general this is false. So this doesn't hold. So Kato suggested a different analog and said, maybe this is needs to be interpreted a different way. Namely, if you look at this in terms of the mth version, then you can say maybe reinterpret this as a local global principle for the mth version in the Brauer group for all m. Well, I'm just going to write Brauer m because, you know, it's local global principle for that involves this and the Brauer groups of the completions. Maybe I'll put the F here. Okay. And then that is the second Galois cohomology with coefficients in mu m. And now the question is, how does this maybe generalize to higher dimensional fields? Well, maybe you should think of this as the second cohomology of F with coefficients in a twist of Z mod M. So I'm just going to define this in the case where it's easy to define, namely where the characteristic of the field doesn't divide M, because we're going to need that assumption later. He suggests that maybe what you should look at is a corresponding local global principle where you consider the nth cohomology and you twist by n minus 1. So the difference here on the exponent and the twist is 1. And you go to the product. I'm not going to say over what this product is for now. Over suitable completions. So that's what he suggested, and he proved a result that, so he proved that this is injective if n is equal to 3 and f is the function field of a surface over a finite field. So that's exactly that case where that other theorem, one of the cases where the other theorem fails. And in that case, you would have here the set of all discrete valuations. And there's a related result for curves over rings of integers over number fields, but then you have to do something special at the Archimedean places. So I'm not going to write that down. So notice that this statement in the case that Kato was considering is actually empty if n is bigger than 3 because the cohomology groups are 0. So it's you can say it's trivially true, but it's not a particularly interesting statement. And as I said earlier, it's false if n is equal to 2. So vacuous what I want to do today is I would like to consider the following setup. So F is the function field from now on of a curve over a complete discretely valued field, capital K, and I'm just going to introduce some notation with ring of integers, T, uniformizer, little t, and residue field. Little k. And now, there may be some people in the audience who object to calling any statement of this sort a local global principle because it's not really going to a global field, but maybe you should call it a local to somewhat less local global, somewhat less local principle. But I don't want to say that the entire time, so I'm just going to keep calling these things local global principles as many other people have done. So so we're going to consider that case, and here's the theorem. So all of this is joint work. Maybe put this here. David Harbater at the University of Pennsylvania and Danny Krashen at the University of Georgia. And it's this talk is based on two papers that are both on the archive, so they're preprint still. So this theorem says the following, that if F is as above, so as over there, and if K is equicharacteristic, and we assume that the characteristic of the residue field doesn't divide M, then this local global map is injective for all n bigger than 1. So even though maybe this isn't quite a local global principle, but a somewhat generally more local situation, the moral seems to be that if you're a bit more local, then maybe more good things happen. And here, the statements for higher n are not necessarily vacuous because K could be any kind of field, and therefore these cohomology groups could be non-trivial for arbitrarily high n. I don't think so, no. There's a different version where we have to assume that the residue field is characteristic zero, where you get something with coefficients in Gm. But I think in this case, no. Okay, and here omega is a set of discrete valuations. I should say that. Discrete rank 1. Actually, it's still true if you only look at the valuations that come from codimension 1 points on a fixed regular model for F over T. But I don't want to go into that right now. So this local global principle, I'm going to try to maybe explain a little bit where this comes from. I guess I can write over here. Is that visible from there or not really? So? Pardon me? The right 2/3, okay. And that's what my students always do, they make me draw a line, okay. So this local global principle comes from a different one. Another theorem that we prove that says the following, that if you let F be as above, so for this you don't need the assumption that K is equicharacteristic, and I will say how that comes in a little moment. So if K is as above, then if X is a regular model for F over T, then, and again, the characteristic of the residue field doesn't divide M, then You can also consider a sort of different local global map where you don't go into the product over all the completions, but what you do is you sort of take all the points on the closed fiber and you look at the corresponding cohomology groups. And here FP so is injective for all n bigger than 1. Here this FP is the fraction field of the complete local ring of x hat of x curly x of p. Here it's important that this is actually over all the points of the closed fiber, not just the closed points. So the generic points of components also have to be in there, otherwise this is actually false. So how do these two relate to each other? Well, in order to relate these two local global principles, one way to do this is to look at these local global maps and look at what their kernels are and try to relate the kernels. So let's define for any field, actually, we define SHA N of F A and let A be commutative group scheme as the kernel of this corresponding local global map. So here you take the set of all discrete valuations and the completions. And then similarly, you can define, again, if X is a model, for F, and now this F is as above, so F is always this function field from now on, then you can define the nth SHA, and we put an index not here to be this kernel of this local global map that we were considering here. Okay. And then the way to relate these two theorems is actually a short exact sequence. Of the following form, one goes to, so I should say if I put an f here instead of this x in the notation, this actually doesn't depend on this on the regular model. So we can also put x here, then maybe I don't have to say that. It doesn't really matter. This goes to SHA and FA, and that goes to a more local version of these SHAs, namely for these fields F sub P. So it's a restricted product over the SHA ends for the various FP. And now this only this product is only over the closed points. And then, so this is for all n bigger than or equal to 1.
What do you mean by
all but finitely many entries. All but finitely many entries are 0.
The rest of
I guess.
Yeah.
Well, no, but I mean, for each, it could be, yeah, yes. Okay, yes, sorry. Okay, right. And so the trick here is that once you've shown this, then you can use a result of Panin that says that for these local, these FPs, well, it implies that these local shahs actually all vanish in the case that we're considering, namely, so his assumption is that you have a commutative M torsion group scheme and that the characteristic doesn't divide M. And there you need the assumption of equicircuit characteristic. That's where that comes in. So using a result of Panin, about the Cousin complex, we show that all these local things vanish. Okay. And then this is how the two local global principles relate to each other. Now the question is, where does this global principle for points on the closed fiber come from? And that actually, in order to get that, we consider a different sort of local global principle where the right-hand side is actually just a finite product. So we have an auxiliary setup where here you have infinite products, and in this case also over the points of the closed fiber, but we're going to reduce this to some sort of finite setup. So what we do is we take, as before, a regular model for F over T, and we let script P be a finite non-empty set of points, of closed points, including, well, for certain things it's sufficient to include all the points where different components of the closed fiber meet, but for other things it's, and that's why I'm making this hypothesis right away, including all the points where also components might self-intersect. You know, so including all the points at which the closed fiber is not unibranched. And that gives you a geometric setup, namely you can now look at the complement, and that's a union of components, and you can let U be the set of such components. And then you can do the following for each P in P, script P, define FP as over there, so it's the fraction field of the complete local ring. And for each U in U, we also define a field. And so these guys are going to be smaller, so they're going to somehow capture more of these points. And this is going to be the fraction field of the T adic completion. T was our uniformizer of the set of all functions on F which are regular at all points in U. And the way this local global principle, so the local global principle that I'm about to state will be with respect to those fields. So it'll be finitely many because there are finitely many FPs and finitely many FUs. But the way this comes about is actually that these FPs and these FUs, at least if you just look at a pair 1P and 1U, they live in some common overfield. And I need to still define that. So for each such P, and each height 1 prime, script P in the the local ring. I didn't say that. So I'm going to call that RP hat. This is the complete local ring. We define our script p hat to be the completion. The localization of RP hat at that prime ideal, and then F subscript P, the fraction field. So this is the set of, sorry. This one? Yeah. Well, it's the function. If you look at this completion, and it's the functions on.
Before
you complete it. Okay. No, but if you complete it, you can think of it as the functions on some t-adic thickening of that set U.
Is this like a really bad
thing? No, not necessarily. I mean, it depends on how bad. Okay. So, for example, you can let X be just the line, and you can take out just one point, say the point. Infinity, and then U is the affine line, and then this would be this completion would be k if bracket x double bracket t if x is the parameter for the line, and then the fraction field is that you have no nice way of writing down. But these other two fields would actually be all right. So this FP would just be the fraction field of the double power series ring in x inverse and t, and this. Field that comes from the branch would be it would be Laurent series in X and then iterated Laurent series in T.
So like for example, it's like the
priori. Because of the choice of use, it's maybe not a priori, but you can show that it's a domain. Yeah, and actually that's a very good comment because we're working on setups where you don't have to make these assumptions and where maybe things can be on various components and then they don't have to be domains, but it seems like the other stuff still works. So. All right, so with the help of that, so for these fields, we get the following. That's Maya via Torres type sequence. So here A is Z mod MZ twisted for any n where that's where we've defined that. And it goes from 0 to A of F to A of, so I'm going to make a shorthand notation here, which I don't have space for. Put that here. I'm just going to collect all these fields that come from the piece into a product, and I'm going to collect all these fields that come from the U's into a product, and I'm going to collect all the fields that come from the branches into a product. And then I can write this down more easily. So this goes to the direct product, and this is the type of map that we would be considering in the local order principle. But now we're going, taking the difference, going to this overlap field. So this geometrically this corresponds somehow to the overlap, and then now I am going to use this lower board. Then you get the same here for H1.
Algebraic functions that
Okay, so this is the part that I'm not going to say so much about, but we'll look at this in a slightly different context a little bit later. But you can prove this Meyer-Vietori sequence for this specific setup. And once you have that, then it can be used to prove the following theorem. I can't move this board. So f as above and so forth, so for all n bigger than 1, the following is injective. You go from f z mod n z n minus 1 to the product over all elements in these sets p and u. So proof sketch, if you believe this Meyer-Vietori sequence, then if you want to prove injectivity at some level, then it should come from surjectivity on the previous level. So what we show explicitly is that it's surjective on the first level. And then, which is not very difficult, so for H1, which gives you the injectivity for H2, but now we can use Bloch-Kato, which says that every element in the nth cohomology here, where we would like surjectivity, is a product of n things in the first cohomology. Now there's a slight thing that I haven't mentioned, a slight sort of, this is the diagonal. A slight issue is that this isn't really a ring homomorphism because of we're taking the difference, but what you can actually show is that even if you just went from AF1 to AF0 and so forth, from H1 F1A, or generally HN FNA to HN F0A, then that's still surjective. And it's just because you're only looking at cohomology with Z mod N, MZ coefficients possibly twisted, and then at the first level where we actually need to show the surjectivity, this cohomology group in question is just the field modulo its mth powers, and so all you have to show is that everything in this field F0 can be written as something in the field F1 times an mth power of something in here. And that's a type of Weierstrass preparation result that we can explicitly show for these types of fields. So this is how this goes. All right. Now I did want to say very briefly something about a sort of a concrete application, but I don't have very much time right now. So I'm just going to mention that there are lots of examples where you have cohomological invariants that take values in these cohomology groups with coefficients in these twisted Z mod Ms. So for example, if you know what Alvit algebras are, there are some invariants that detect whether those are reduced or split or whether they're automorphism groups or anisotropic or something like that. And you can and they all take values in cohomology groups to which our theorem applies. And so therefore, you can detect all these properties locally. So the other comment that I want to make before I shift gears and the topic is that this result of panning, I'm not an expert, but I get the idea that people believe that this is true even if you don't assume equi characteristic. And so this would then imply that our theorems would also work more generally. Okay. So all of this is for n bigger than 1, and so the obvious question is what happens when n is equal to 1? And in that case, the local global principles can actually fail, but we can, using again the setup over there, which I'm going to leave, and the methods that we've developed, we can again, in many cases, say when it fails and describe the obstruction, which is again some version, some sort of Tate-Shafarevich set actually because we're going to look more generally now at arbitrary linear algebraic groups, not necessarily commutative, and not just Z mod M's. And we can describe the obstruction quite explicitly. So that's going to be the second part of the talk. So you want to relate the cohomology of F with coefficients in A to this cohomology of one of these F xi's with coefficients in A. And the way you do this is you use some intermediate object where some Galois module that relates the two such that these two are actually equal in the case of our fields. And then that gives you a short exact sequence from which the Myers-Viator sequence comes out very easily. So that's how it, but it's something that's very specific. So we sort of, in the paper, we pulled out the hypothesis that you actually need. So you can theoretically use it for a different setup, but I don't know of any other setup that would satisfy this. So you know, we call this globally dominated or F-dominated for the cohomology. So but that's how that comes about. Bit over here, so I'm gonna move this. Okay, so we're now gonna consider arbitrary linear algebraic groups. So non-abelian Galois cohomology. And this will, in some cases, also say something about what would happen here for n equals to 1. So, what about n equals 1, or n equals 0 for that matter? So now G is an arbitrary linear algebraic group over F. And we're going to consider H1 of FG. So the first Galois cohomology set, so that's now defined as the set of isomorphism classes of principal homogeneous spaces, i.e. torsors up to, or you can do equivalence classes of one co-cycles, but there aren't any co-boundaries or something. Yeah? So this is not a group. If G is not commutative, but a pointed set. So it's still got an element 1 in there, which I'm going to denote by 1. And this corresponds to the class of the trivial torsor, so the group itself. And then we can do the exact same thing that we did before. We can look at these local global principles, and we're just going to look straight at their kernels. So we can define SHA of FG to be the kernel of the local global map, where you go, so F is our F from over there, where you go to all the completions with respect to discrete valuations. Or you could look at this SHA naught, where you look at the kernel mapping to all the points of the closed fiber. Corresponding FPs. And then for the third type of local global principle, I didn't even write down the corresponding kernel, but you could do that too. And since this setup here, once you fix your set script P, it's uniquely determined, I'm just going to denote that SHA P of XG. So that's going to be the kernel of this finite local global principle. All right. what does the word kernel mean in this case, since the thing is not a group? So this is just the pre-image of one. So kernel, I'm just using that for the pre-image of one. Okay, and then the theorem is that you get the following exact sequence, which is the analog of this Meyer-Vietoris sequence, but now exact sequence of pointed sets. And it goes like this. You go from 1 to G of F to G of F1 cross G of F0. I'm using my shorthand notation again. So this is the product over all the FUs. This is the product over all the, F2, over all the FUs. This is the product over all the FPs. And then you go to G of F0. Now you have to do this multiplicatively. So this is just going to go to G inverse, G1 inverse G2. And then here you have the corresponding cohomology, the coefficient in G. And then since this isn't, these aren't groups anymore, you now have to do an equalizer at the end of it to get to the cohomology of F0. And there is a connecting map. And I can briefly say something about where this sequence comes from. So the fact that the intersection of these two in here isn't bigger than this, or is exactly this, comes from the fact that we know that for our fields that I've defined over there, the intersection of F1 and F2 in F0 is actually F. So for the people who heard my talk in the member seminar, I always want to say member theory seminar for some reason, but in the member seminar, I talked about the patching methods that that David and Danny and I use. And these fields come up in this patching setup. This is how we thought of applying them to these local Wilbur principles. And one of the properties that you want of these fields in patching is that they intersect to the base field. So that gives you the first exactness there. And then basically everything else follows from the fact that we show that you can not only patch finite dimensional vector spaces with extra structure, which is what I explained in the member seminar, but you can actually also patch torsors. So you can glue torsors. So if you have a torsor, so an element in here, an element in here, they agree here, then you can somehow glue them to get a torsor that lives globally, so over this field F. And this is done in a unique way, which then also allows you to do this connecting homomorph map, actually. Because if you have a set of elements in here, what you can do is you can view them as transition functions that you use to patch together trivial G torsors. And that's how you get an element in here. And this, since this is done in a unique way, this also shows that if you had something here that was trivial here and here, then it would have to come from a trivial torsor that was glued together. And so it would come from a collection of elements over there. So now this shows, so note that the local, so this SHA that we are interested in, and we're again going to, yes, there is some general nonsense. And what you need is that the intersection is the base field and that you can factor GLN. And I'm about to say what that means. I wasn't going to, but I can say very easily in a minute what that means. So notice that, so what we're going to do the same strategy as before. We're going to try and get results about this SHA via results about this SHA naught. And this comes from results about this patching SHA. This patching SHA is now the kernel here. So because of this short exact sequence, the local global principle holds for patches. So by definition, meaning this patching SHA is trivial if and only if we have factorization in G. So this map there is surjective, so you can write g of f naught as g of f1 times g of f2. The inverse there doesn't matter. I've left a little space there because I want to show you an example what that actually means. So for example, if you took this curve here, this is the closed fiber, and you took out this point P, this is your set script P. And then you get one U. But you get two branches here and here. So you get two of these overfields. So you get maybe a script P1 and a script P2. And then if you look at what these inclusions are, so what's going to happen is that you have your branch field here and your branch field here, and you're going to have your FP and your FU and the intersection, well, in this case, it's going to be the inverse limit is F, and there's an inclusion here, and there are inclusions here. So what this factorization means is that you give yourself an element in G of this branch field and in G of this branch field, and then you have one possibility to pick an element in here, an element in here, so that they multiply to this element and to this element with respect to these different inclusions. So these are different inclusions. So that's why this is sort of a simultaneous factorization. And so if you have an abstract set of fields for which simultaneous factorization holds for GLN and they intersect to F, then this Meyer-Vietoris sequence holds, this theorem holds. So it's not just for these specific fields, but that's the case where we apply it. Okay, so that's the factorization. And now, from now on, we're going to make an extra assumption on the group. We're going to assume that G is rational. We can also say things in other cases, but this is the case that we can say most about. So by this I mean that every connected component of G is rational as a variety. So in particular, every component has a point. So this is my definition. That's what we're going to assume. And then in order to study this SHA, the first thing that we're going to do is we're going to simplify what we need to do by saying that the SHA, the patching SHA, and similarly, actually, for the SHA naught, we'll see that in a minute, that this is the same as if you took the SHA, but instead of G, you look at the set of connected components. So now notice that because of this assumption here, this is a finite constant group. So the way this is actually done is that it uses a short exact sequence on the SHAs, where you have the SHA for the connected component in the kernel, and then you have this in the middle, so the proof sketch is this uses a short exact sequence of this form. But now again, so what you do is we can explicitly show that this is actually trivial. So if the group is connected and rational, the patching SHA vanishes. But then you're still not quite done because of the fact that these are just pointed sets and not groups, so you're going to still have to do something to get sort of for the other fibers to get a conclusion, and you just sort of do a version of this. So this is done by just really explicitly showing for our fields that you can do this factorization. And this is pretty messy. So there you have to somehow get your hands dirty a little bit. So this, and then plus something about the other fibers. Yeah. So you somehow mimic this again for the other fibers. In general, if you Well, in general, I was just going to say that, in general, if you look at the fiber, if you look at the kernel for one of these things, for one of these local global principles, if you look at a different fiber, of not of one, you can view that as a kernel for a local global principle for a twisted group. But that's actually not what we do here. In this case, we just somehow... Right, exactly. That's exactly the problem. Yeah. Otherwise, you could just say done. But in this case, you really have to sort of mimic this factorization result again to get that. So now that we have that, we've reduced our work to the case of finite groups, coefficient and finite groups, finite constant groups. And now to study this further, we're going to look at the setup here again in this example. And in more generality, we're going to associate to the closed fiber a graph, which is the reduction graph. It's not quite the classical reduction graph, but almost. Yeah. How do we use that it's connected? We use that it's connected because now we need that if you have a connected rational group and then you take the veil restriction with respect to something, then it's still going to be connected and rational. And this isn't going to work with finite groups or, you know, that's the problem. That's why we need connected. And it's actually, the final result will show that it's actually false in general for finite groups. So you wouldn't have any chance to use that. But that's how that's used because remember when I said this example of the projective line, the way that you show these properties of these fields, this factorization and the intersection, is that you show it for this baby example with a line. And then in the general case, what you do is you map your curve to the line. And you can show that you can choose the map such that all these points here map to infinity, say. And then these are just going to be the pre-images of the affine, the components of the pre-image of the affine line. And then you can use the factorization downstairs and veil restriction to get the factorization upstairs. And that's how that comes in. OK, so to study this further, in particular when G is finite, we introduce the reduction graph of X. So this is a bipartite graph with vertices in bijection to this set P, that's one vertex set, and then this set U, that's the other vertex set, and then edges in bijection with these branches. So there is an edge between a P and a U if and only if P is on the closure of U, and it could happen in various ways, it could be various branches. So an example is that curve from before where P is this and just the exact same setup. And then what would the graph look like? Well, you'd have an FP here and an FU. So those are the two vertices of the graph. And the bipartite tells you that this is the one set and this is the other set. And then there's two branches connecting them, so this will look like this. And what we can show is that this graph somehow controls the obstruction. So what happens is that this SHA is the same as take homomorphisms from the fundamental group of this graph gamma which depends on P on this chosen set, but it turns out that doesn't matter so much in the end. And then you take the group of connected components and then you have to mod out by conjugation. So now, the fundamental group of a graph is a free group. This is a finite group. So you have a pretty good control here. So in particular, um, this be trivial? Well, if this is trivial, so then this is trivial modulo conjugation, but a group modulo conjugation is going to be trivial if and only if this was already trivial. So now, if this is trivial, then since this is a free group and this is a finite group, the only way this can happen is if either this is trivial or this is trivial. So either G is connected, or, well, the fundamental group is trivial if and only if the thing is a tree, so it doesn't have loops. So one direction is a baby exercise. If this is a tree, you can always factor, well, how? Because then the simultaneous issue isn't going to be an issue. Because you know, if you have a tree, you just start at one leaf, and then you just pick this thing arbitrary, and you have something prescribed for the edge because that corresponds to that g of f naught that you want to factor. The sequence isn't here anymore, so I can't read. It's still there. It's hidden. Yes, right. So you want to factor. Thank you very much. You want to factor something in here, and then you just do that for the first branch that corresponds to one of these elements, and then you just keep going, and you don't run into problems because there aren't any loops. So that's a trivial exercise. The problem is sort of the other direction. So this is trivial if and only if G is connected or this gamma is a tree. So now, how do we get from the patching SHA back to what we originally wanted? Well, there's a way to go from the patching SHA to this SHA naught, which I didn't explain in the previous setup either, but it's not so difficult because somehow the open sets, the information that you have there, you recapture from the generic points of the closed fiber. And then the other points you just have in that open set. So that doesn't change anything. And then you get, excuse me, you get from SHA naught to SHA by a very similar short exact sequence that we had before. So there's again a short exact sequence relating this and this, with where the co-kernel is sort of a more local SHA with respect to these FPs. And again, there are results by other people that say when these things vanish. And so one explicit example, so that we have one explicit result maybe up on the board, is the following corollary. So one of them is where we do this explicit factorization, we use rationality. Okay, we know factorization for GLN for our sorts of fields, and now what we do is you somehow, first you show that it's sufficient to factor things that are close to identity in this metric. And then you somehow map a neighborhood of the identity to some affine space, and then there you can factor it by what you did for GLN, more or less. I mean, what you kind of want to do is you want to say, rather than factor it, you want to additively decompose it mod t for high, and then mod t to the t square, mod t to the n, and so forth. That's not quite what's going on because you don't. So instead of factoring in the group, you want to somehow factor in the Lie algebra or something like that. This is sort of the idea behind it, but it doesn't quite work that way. But that's where we need that rationality. But then the rationality is actually for this result. For this result here, it's also used because we need that the map from G to the connected to the set of connected components is surjective on rational points for any overfield of the where the group is defined over. Okay, so one explicit corollary, maybe, about the valuation SHA is the following. If either little k, so this was the residue field, is algebraically closed of characteristic 0, or if the connected component is defined and reductive over a regular model of F, then this patching SHA is equal to the shot that we're interested in. And in particular, you can then explicitly describe this in terms of the reduction graph. I mean, you have pretty good control over this because you can write down the graph and then you can almost see explicitly what this is. So let me just state one last consequence. There's a little bit of space here. It's not pretty, but just to go back to the theorem that we started with, if you look at the case of the Brouwer group, if you look at isomorphism classes of centered simple algebras, then you can classify them by H1 of F PGLN. And then you apply all of what we've done to this, and so you get, as a consequence, that the Brouwer group satisfies this local Bulber principle. This was actually known, and in a paper of Colli-Tallien, Parimala, and Suresh, which is also based on our methods, but with different techniques. They did this with different techniques. but this is something that you can get out of there. And for the people who heard my talk in the member seminar, there I was talking about quadratic forms, and you can look at the Witt group, and you can look at what the kernel is there when you go to the valuations. And we saw that it's non-trivial. And this is going to be exactly the homomorphisms of this, the fundamental group of this reduction graph. And now the coefficients are going to be, so the group in question is the orthogonal group. It's a group of connecting components. It's the special orthogonal group. So it's just going to be a Z-mod 2. So it's an elementary abelian 2 group that you get here. And you can say exactly what its rank is, which depends on this graph. So in particular, if the curve is just the line, then this would this would just be trivial. So this resolves some problem that we had in this in this other work about quadratic forms, where somehow the local Glober principle for the orthogonal group would work if the quadratic form has dimension bigger than 2, but it doesn't work for dimension 2. That's exactly sort of what was going on. But it works if the curve is good. So it still works for dimension 2 if the curve is a line, for example. So, OK. Thank you very much for your attention.